Additive manufacturing applications improve the lives of people, but what about animals?
We'll look at a case where 3D printing is improving the lives of animals here at the Cincinnati Zoo in this episode of The Cool Part Show. Season 3 of The Cool Part Show is brought to you by Carpenter Additive. The company's Athens, Alabama Emerging Technology Center is an end-to-end additive manufacturing production facility, with everything from materials development through post-processing under one roof, ready to help you with your next metal 3D printing job. Check them out at carpenteradditive.com. Now, back to the show.
I'm Pete.
I'm Stephanie.
We're with additivemanufacturing.media, and this is The Cool Parts Show, our show all about cool, amazing, interesting 3D printed parts.
This is our first on-site episode of The Cool Parts Show. We are here at the Cincinnati Zoo and Botanical Garden, and we're going to be talking about a 3D printing application here that's used for the animals with the help of some special guests.
We're going to talk about meerkats, because who wouldn't want to talk about meerkats? But we're also going to talk about something bigger, which is additive manufacturing's potential to solve problems, including problems you didn't even imagine could have a connection to 3D printing.
So while you're enjoying the antics of these little guys behind us, we're going to be talking about a 3D printed enrichment device that was made right here in Cincinnati.
Yeah, this is a great hometown story for us. We are based in Cincinnati. This involves GE Additive, a company based in Cincinnati. And the Cincinnati Zoo and Botanical Gardens is a real source of local pride for us. But this is also a story about building bridges between different disciplines. And as we'll explore, this one was a pretty big bridge.
Yeah, so before we get too far into this, the part that we're going to be talking about is actually behind us in the meerkat enclosure. So regular viewers of the show are used to seeing us sitting behind a table handling the part. Today the meerkats are going to be doing the handling. And what we're looking at is this thing that kind of looks like an upright tree stump in here. This is a 3D printed enrichment device. It's three pieces of titanium assembled together. And it looks solid, but actually like there's this internal chamber where a zookeeper can add crickets. And there are all these different channels in the inside where the live crickets can kind of make their way out slowly into the enclosure where they then are eaten by the animals.
Slowly is the key to the enrichment. The crickets coming out at their own natural pace as they would find their way out. So the challenge of feeding animals in a zoo is it's possible to feed them too easily and too quickly. These meerkats could get fed physically and wouldn't be stimulated mentally. And the feeder is all about that, making eating a little challenging for the meerkats. So before we go farther, meerkats. What can you tell us about these animals?
So meerkats are from Africa. They are part of the mongoose family, and they're burrowing creatures, so you'll see them digging around behind us. And fun fact, the group or the mob that we have here in Cincinnati actually came from Disney's Animal Kingdom, and they're all related.
What do they eat?
They are omnivores, but I believe that one of their favorite foods is bugs.
And so that gets to the story that we want to tell. How these animals eat, how to feed the meerkats naturally. Somebody who thinks a lot about that, how to replicate the natural experience of the animals, is Cincinnati Zoo's Animal Excellence Manager, David Orban. Let's hear from him.
So I would describe this as kind of a slow cricket feeder almost. Really, we have a lot of animals here at the zoo that we care for that consume insects as part of their diet. And so what we wanted to do is have a way to slowly disperse live crickets into the animal's environment, therefore extending the foraging behavior that an animal might be doing. So this device, it has a central vessel in it that crickets can be placed into. And then from that central vessel, there is a network of basically maze-like tubes that lead to the exterior of the device. So crickets can then move their way from the center of the device to the exterior of it kind of at their leisure and when they choose. So this allows crickets to be slowly dispersed into the environment and for there to be some randomization in terms of location and time. So we've now tested the device with a few different species, including meerkats, sandcats, and fennec foxes, as well as multiple different species of birds, including blue-crowned thrushes and white-crowned shama thrushes. And we've noticed amongst all of those different animals, different investigative behaviors, foraging behaviors. We really, you know, we're happy to see that our animals were spending a lot of time searching for and digging around and listening for crickets and then consuming them when they did see them.
Okay, so David talked about what is going on the inside of this feeder. And I actually talked to Shannon Jagodinsky, who's an AdWorks engineer at GE Additive. She worked on this, and here's how she described the design.
The exterior of this device has a tree bark-like structure printed into the outside so that it looks natural and fits into the environment. The top and bottom lids even have rings from a tree printed into them to make it look pretty natural, which is pretty neat. But the inside is way more complex than you would think just by looking at this replicated tree trunk. So we actually used internal fuel nozzle winding passageway type thought process to create all of these tubes that wind in throughout the tree trunk. And the tubes are different lengths because the zoo had asked us to create a sort of delayed timing feeder. So depending on which tube a cricket will select, it'll take the cricket a different amount of time to walk through a shorter tube versus a longer tube. And then the tubes are even big enough that the crickets can turn around if they want and crawl back into the device. And they can stay in the device as long as they want. Eventually, they'll come out and search for food.
So man, with GE, it always comes back to the fuel nozzle, doesn't it?
It totally does, yes.
But this is not an aircraft part. Nevertheless, it's made out of titanium. Is there any sense where this is a little over-engineered?
You know, okay, that's what I thought too at first. But there's actually a couple of good reasons that this is made out of titanium. And some of them are the same reasons you would make aerospace parts out of titanium. It's lightweight, it's easy for the keepers to handle. It's strong, it's durable, it's gonna hold up to a lot of different animals using it in different ways. But also kind of the bigger reason is that titanium is a pretty safe material. So we use it for medical implants, we use it for surgical instruments. It's safe for humans to be in contact with, and it's likewise safe for animals to be interacting with like this.
So isn't that funny? Because the animal enrichment team here at the zoo, they're used to making things by hand, right? Making things out of wood or paper mache or PVC pipe. I bet they never imagined they would have a 3D printed titanium enrichment component. And it sort of gets at the gulf between these two disciplines, and it was a pretty wide gulf that was bridged by this collaboration. First, okay, we're talking about additive. We got to cover the technology, right? What was the additive process used to make this?
So GE Additive used electron beam melting, or EBM, specifically an Arcam Q20 Plus. So you might remember GE acquired Arcam a couple years ago. And this is it's a powder bed technology. It's really similar to laser sintering, which we've talked about before. The main difference is that instead of a laser as your power source, you have an electron beam, and that whole bed of powder is preheated. So you have to kind of break your parts out of this cake of powder instead of just lifting them out of the loose powder. So that technology allowed GE to build this device out of titanium, so it's really strong and durable, but also allowed them to incorporate those really interesting internal features that kind of show off what additive can do.
Yeah, so turning to additive manufacturing gave the zoo access to all this capability, all this design freedom. And then from that point, this sort of turned into the kind of story we see with additive, right? Trying to solve a new problem with it. The problem in this case, how to get crickets to naturally exit the device the way crickets want to do, a problem never before confronted, never before addressed by additive manufacturing. And the team had to get together to work that out. And there was prototyping, there was iteration, there was exploring ideas. David Orban spoke about that.
Originally, when we started designing, I think there was really the idea to have that central chamber be a lot smaller. The tunnels inside were a lot longer and had a lot more different angles. So one thing that we did is we started to test some of those different features of the device before actually building the whole unit itself. So working with actually one of our insect team here at the zoo, we brought some different pieces that were kind of test prints to that building, and we tested some of those basically different size and textures of tunnels, and we wanted to see you know, what crickets would use and what they would feel most comfortable with to either turn around or maybe to bypass one another, or could they even navigate up a steep tunnel itself. So really working through that together, we made some adjustments to the diameter of the tubes, to the size of the internal vessel.
Wow, so that's funny. Like, the first beta users for this feeder were actually the food.
Right.
So, okay, in addition to the cricket experience, GE had to consider a couple of other things in building this feeder. And so here's what Shannon had to say about that, kind of starting from maybe the predator's perspective.
In addition to animal safety, we had to consider all of their body parts, which sounds kind of weird. But we had to think about nails, claws, beaks, teeth, things that could get stuck in certain geometries that we could create with additive. We had to make sure that we were avoiding any type of geometry that could lead to an animal injury. And then in terms of safety for the humans interacting with the device, we had to keep the device within a maintainable weight to pick up and carry in and out of the enclosure. And then also had to make sure that the keepers had a way to keep the device clean. So we had to think about that when we were designing it as well. One of the other requirements that the zoo wanted us to use in this project was to make something that looked natural in the animal's enclosure. They wanted something that wouldn't stick out like a sore thumb for people that were coming to the zoo. Something to look sort of like trees or foliage. That an animal would see out in the wild. And then the last set of restrictions and requirements that we had were just in terms of the technology side. We had to make sure that whatever we came up with had to fit inside of one of our additive machines.
All right, so I listen to them speak. I hear Shannon talk, I hear David talk, and they're describing the same application and the same set of problems, but from the framework of their two different perspectives. And even both of them, I'm hearing them sort of allude to part of the challenge of this, and really part of the fun of this, was these two different disciplines and these two different organizations kind of understanding each other and understanding how to communicate with each other about this application, about solving this problem. Like, so this is an additive manufacturing story, this is a meerkat story, but like, really, this is a people story, ultimately.
Yeah, so, you know, there are these two organizations, they're both in Cincinnati, very close geographically, experts in their fields, and the challenge here is not so much the design or the manufacturing of this device, it's how do we talk to each other? How do we express what it is that the problem we need to solve on the one hand, and how do we explain what it is that we can do and how additive can solve this problem on the other hand?
So the first couple times we met with them, we really just kind of explained where each side was coming from. So we would explain the benefits of additive technology. We would explain the limitations of additive technology. And the zoo team would explain to us what they needed help with, why they had certain problems. And once we gained a deep understanding of both sides of the story, we were able to mesh together and do a bunch of brainstorming sessions. And the most important part of those brainstorming sessions was having people at the zoo that would actually interact with the animals and could give us firsthand experiences of what they needed help with.
You know, we had a lot of fun just learning from each other, and I think also challenging one another to think a little bit more creatively and outside the box. You know, I know that just even when they first came out to our zoo to meet with our team, they brought like two or three boxes of just different things that they've been able to print. From like a flexible chainmail to you know, a metal ball within a ball, like the opportunities that are can come from additive technology seem endless, at least from my perspective. So that was exciting for us, and I know when a few of those individuals came out to test the textures and the sizes of some of those 3D printed parts with crickets, I know a few of the members were not big fans of insects. So being in a room filled with insects all around you in different terrariums is a little bit nerve-wracking for them. But again, they were great sports about it. And I think we learned a lot from each other through that experience.
Pete, you know what? Other than the bugs, like, this story really isn't that weird.
How so?
So I think about previous people that we've talked to, and like I think a lot of additive manufacturers have been in Shannon's shoes, where you're sitting down across the table from a new customer, and you know, maybe they're just learning about 3D printing for the first time, or they're not fully aware of all the things it can do, and you have to kind of just talk it out. You know, what is 3D printing? What are its capabilities? How is it going to help in this situation? At the same time, I think we've spoken to a lot of people kind of like David, who have some sort of problem and maybe they don't even see it as a problem, and somehow they find their way to 3D printing as the solution.
Yeah, so we're here at the zoo, we're at an unusual place, but really we could be anywhere, because the story of additive really is, it has this potential for solving problems, and really just the connection has to be made. Just the organization with that problem somehow has to recognize that 3D printing holds the solution. Let me see if I've got all this, okay? All right, so we're at the Cincinnati Zoo and Botanical Gardens. 3D printing was used to make this feeding device. It has internal passageways that encourage crickets to find their way out, as crickets will, according to cricket agendas, at cricket speeds, so that the meerkats are enriched. The device is titanium. It was, and titanium was the material chosen for several reasons, including its safety for the animals, its ruggedness and durability for the long term. It was made through electron beam melting, a powder bed fusion process on an Arcam machine from GE Additive, and GE Additive engineers and animal personnel with the zoo worked together to explore the solution and find the right feeder design. And part of the challenge of it was these two organizations, one that's very concerned with and understands the well-being of animals, and one that is focused on engineering and 3D printing, them talking together, coming together to find this successful feeding device that's now enriching our hosts, the meerkats.
Yeah, so I think that's it. But there's one more kind of communication aspect to this story. So Shannon told me that GE Additive is actually working on making a couple more of these feeders. And there's going to be one that has sort of this like cutout section so you can see what's going on in the inside. And the zoo is going to use that as a demo piece for school groups and other visitors, so that while people are here learning about animals, they can also be learning about 3D printing at the same time.
Okay, so let's make a promise. When that's here at the zoo and available, we'll update the audience so you all can come see it.
Yeah, and if you ever find yourself in Cincinnati, highly recommend visiting the zoo and, you know, take a look around, see if you can spot some of these cool parts.
So that does it. Thank you for watching. Thanks for watching the Cool Parts Show. If you have a cool 3D printed part you're working on that tells an interesting story, maybe like this one, contact us. We might feature it in an episode. coolparts@additivemanufacturing.media.
If you like the show, subscribe. You can find all of the past episodes on YouTube or thecoolpartshow.com, and more about industrial 3D printing at additivemanufacturing.media. Thanks for watching. Thank you to our sponsor, Carpenter Additive. Listen to Additive Manufacturing podcasts, attend webinars, and learn more at carpenteradditive.com.